Okay, so please, Sonia, thank you for the introduction.
Okay, good morning, everyone. I will do a little introduction about our guest, Camillo Magni. Camillo is working since many years contemporaneously as an architect in its own studio, opera studio, that received many awards, as a professor at Politecnico di Milano, where he's also director of the Master in Design for Development, as well as in the editorial field, as he's editor of the Italian journal Casabella and curator of the Swiss journal Archi. His approach is characterized by a particular attention and sensibility to the domestic dimension of the architectural project in relation to very different contexts. His main topic of investigation are specifically housing and emergency. Since 2007, he is president of Architetti Senza Frontiere Italia, a non-profit organization that focuses its attention in the field of socially responsive designing, enhancing unprivileged sectors of world population. His efforts are focalizing on the comprehension of these wicked and complex realities, trying to, in every occasion, to find the potential of each place, giving value to it through architectural reflections. And now I give the floor to him. We really thank you to join us.
Thanks a lot. Really, thanks a lot to invite me. For me, it's quite interesting to have this opportunity to stay with you. In 1997, I spent 2 months for an international workshop in Pavia with Remo Dorigati. I don't know if you remember Carlo, and he, with Bugatti, they did some international workshop in Pavia, and it has been a really interesting experience. And great, so for me it's quite, and then I came back also other times in your university. So I'm very happy to be here. And I'm going now to share my screen. Can you see the screen? Perfectly, okay. So Okay, I put the timer only to be sure and to control the time. Okay, 45 minutes, starting from now. Okay, so today I would like to focus my attention on specific issues. I know that your workshop, the main topic of your workshop is about mobile architecture. And to be honest, I never work on these specific issues. And I think that it could be interesting for you if I share some information from my personal experience talking about the process. For this reason, this lecture, I tried to define this lecture as from the product to the process. And the idea is try to shift the topic and to think about not what to build, but how to build. And is a way to move, to shift the attention to the, not to the, from the final product to the process. And the second point that I would like to underline is my personal experience, and what I'm going to share with you. I work in different contexts, and in this case, I would like to share some specific experience that I've done into the international cooperation context. It's a specific context that I think that is quite interesting, because it makes evidence some specific issues that we should discuss together about it. All the time I start with this very simple sketch made by Victor Pelli. It's a very famous, a simple sketch, and in each lecture I'm very happy to share this image. And Victor Pelli, the more famous Cesar Pelli brothers, and in these drawings we can recognize the process. We can recognize a very simple process that happen in the into informal segments. That is the transformation from a first step, this image, make evidence how an informal structure occupy a plot. Into the plot, we can recognize two different informal structures, one toilet and one informal housing. Second, the second step underline us how around the humid area, how around the toilet area, the specific house develop it and begin to improve its own quality. And the third step show us how a informal housing has been changed in a formal housing. And this is a typical process that characterizes the informal settlement around the world. In this image made in Kenya, I forgot the neighborhood name, doesn't matter, show us very well the context. We can recognize the repetition of informal housing, repeated many times, and the context is made by hundred of the same informal structure. Also in this image from Phnom Penh, we are in a waste dump where 5,000 people live. And in this image show us very well how the informal settlement is made by informal structure. And at the end of this street, we can recognize, for example, these guys, the people who live into this specific house, that they begin to change the quality of their own home, and they begin to improve the structure, changing the wood, for example, changing the wood structure, the iron sheet walls with concrete bricks and so on. This image, I think that is quite interesting for us because it is, here we are in Asunción, in Paraguay. This is an informal settlement closer to the Paraná River. During the rain season, this is a very huge, large floating area, and the river grow up 2 times each year. And I think that this image is quite interesting because show us, for example, here, a family that is just arrived into this informal settlement. And again, we can recognize again the informal structure, wood structure, iron sheet for the roof, for the walls, and many problems with the water, electric, electric line, and so on. But behind, we can recognize the people who live here since 30, 40 years ago, that they begin to change the informal structure with some other material, bricks, again, bricks, walls, concrete, tiles, and so on. And this image explains very well as how they begin to, how they are working into a process instead to work into a product. This image is made in El Ejido, in the south of Spain. Again, we are in a waste dump where they were living some thousand of people that work, some worker in the field, in the agricultural field. And these two images, I think that are quite interesting because they show us two things. First of all, that the structure is quite informal. It's quite informal, but at the same time, we can recognize some details. For example, please pay attention to this little roof or this plan, this little bench that underline how these guys, how the people who live into this informal settlement try to enforce, to improve their own quality. And a lock here, this is quite interesting, is crazy to lock this door in a very informal structure that is quite easy to enter in, but he decided to insert a lock to protect his own house. So I think that all these elements are quite interesting to underline that we are working into a process, as we have seen in Victor Pelli's drawings, from the beginning, from the informal to formal. And I think that is quite evident when we are talking about refugees camp, that is a way to design the future city. Here we are in Dabab, we can recognize how this urban, how this organization defined the future urban structure. We can recognize the main road, the main urban block, and into the urban block, the different singular plots. And here we are in Darvai, in Zaatri, in Jordan area. And again, also in this case, we can recognize how the informal structure will define the future urban structure of the city. And this image, I think that is quite interesting for us, for me, for us, for everybody, because it shows us how the process begin from the first step, that is to define the singular plot. In this case, we are in an external neighborhood of Bombay in India, and the plot is, the dimension of the plot was made for a tent, for a mobile architecture, and it was 3 meter deep for 10 meter, sorry, 3 meter, 10 meter deep. And of course, after 10 years, it begin to, the tent has been changed with a formal structure that begin to grow up, one floor, second floor, and here we can recognize the third floor. So it's crazy to think that this structure grow up on a so small plot, only 3 meter deep. And that is, I mean, that is crazy and is a way to think very well how to organize the dimension of the plot, and coming back here, and the dimension of the organization of the different refugees camp. Here, for example, we are in La Balanza, in the north, it's a neighbor, external neighborhood in the north of Lima. And here you can recognize the first step. The singular plot is recognized, is defined by this informal structure, very, very quincha. It's difficult to translate this. It's a specific way to build this tent. That is changed with this. This is the second step that is changed with this wood structure, and this is the end. Now the balanza, the context of the balanza is this one. So the process from this step to the end, I think that is the crucial point for us. And I think that is quite interesting for you, that you are working into the mobile architecture. Here we are in Italy and in Milan, and we are working in with a gypsy community here closer to the cemetery, and they were living here in an informal way, 1,000 people, and the government, the local government, decided to organize a camp. These are the first image about the camp. This is the typical typical solution that the government offered to these people, 2 meter and 30 for 8 meter, 9 meter, eight and a half. And into this block, there are 8 beds. So 8 people are living into this architecture. And this is the urbanization that is quite basic. And talking about the process and not the product, I think that is quite interesting to understand what happened after the government solution. The first step, as we have seen in the drawing made by Vittor Pelli, the first step is to occupy the external land with some informal structure. First of all, this very informal structure, to bring out the kitchen, and then to build with wood an additional external structure, and again then here you can recognize that the wood is chained with concrete blocks. The roof, again, here you can recognize the both, the original structure and the new one. And this is the end. Behind this structure, into this house, there is the original one. And I think that this is crazy, it's quite crazy, but it's also quite interesting for us because it explains us very well the process where we are working in. And again, in these drawings, we can recognize this process. For this reason, the main point is to understand how architecture can improve local development. That means to shift the main issues from how to what to build, but what you want to improve through your architecture. So the main question, the main topic is how architecture can improve local development. The second point is how it's possible to use our technical skills in the human settlement. What does it mean? I'm architect, I think that is interesting. The main topic is not to design or to produce architecture, but to improve the local development. But my personal skills, our personal skills are directly connected to architecture. So the problem is how it's possible to use our technical skills into this context, human settlements, and how specific issues as architecture can be changed in a new social perspective. At the end, the main problem is how to be an architect in this context, in the global south. So I'm going to share very quickly three different examples, three different experiences. The first one is a research made by into the CITED. CITED is an international organization, Scienze e Tecnologia para il Desarrollo, is an international organization from South Central America, Ibero-America context, that means South America, Central America, Latin American, and Spain and Portugal. And this research, I have been involved for 4 years. I think that is quite interesting for us because explore different techniques to improve the self-construction into the informal settlement. The main idea is quite simple. I think that everybody of yours know very well IKEA. IKEA is a way to think about the furniture in a totally different way from the past. Is a new way to consider furniture, and the main point is this one. Through a specific tools, this like this one, to transfer knowledge to no handwork, specialized handworkers. And in this way, I think that it's quite easy to understand. I think that IKEA, all of us, is able to build a library, for example, a furniture like this one, alone, through some specific tools like these details. And I think that this is a quite easy process. And we thought if it's possible to bring this approach from the furniture to the houses. And since the Tecnologia per Arroyo tried to define some specific techniques to bring the people to build alone their own houses. And I'm going to show three, they developers, I think 75 different techniques. I'm going to share three or four different techniques. And the main idea is to divide the house, the construction, in different parts and to think how to improve the pre-casting construction training non-specialized workers into this process. For example, I very quickly, I am going to share three different techniques. The first one is how to build the iron lines for the beams and for pillars. And to involve no specialized workers means to use three different rules, very simple three different rules. No shattering, because to use shatter is too complicated, and you need to involve specialized worker. So no shattering, no electric machine, and no any elements heavier than 100 kilograms. So with these three very simple rules, you should rethink how to build the different part of the house. In this case, here we are, this project is made by SEVE. SEVE is a very interesting organization in Cordoba, in Argentina, Centro de Investigación sobre la Vivienda Económica. And I think that they started 30 or 40 years ago in Cordoba, and they experiment a lot of different techniques. I think that is one of the more interesting investigation center in South America about informal settlement. Here, they train these techniques, how to build iron lines and to combine, and very quickly you can recognize the principal bars, and they are the smaller and cheaper bars, Fe4 and Fe8, the number 8 for the principal line and number 4 for the secondary lines. And you can recognize that is exactly the same elements that you can combine in different way, and with some specific join to define the 90 degree join, the 90 degree connection. And I think that is also interesting to recognize that is exactly the same elements for beams, pillar, and vertical external beams and vertical beams. Very quickly, we can recognize how they build this element. It's quite easy. They organize a factory with some specific elements that help the people to build these principal elementary elements and combine the different bars and the joints. It's easy to organize and to define the beams and the pillars. And the second step is how to build the panels, the walls, and the idea is to transform the walls into precasting panels. And the idea is that the cheaper elements in this context is brick, and the idea is quite easy, instead to use the brick in this way, in the horizontal way, to use brick in the vertical way. That is the way to use only the 30% of the bricks. That means that it is cheaper and lighter. Here in this image, you can recognize the dimension of the panels, and very quickly, this is the brick, is a solid brick, 3 centimeter deep. This is the external frame. Very quickly, you can recognize the external frame, the bricks, some iron bars to reinforce the horizontal line. And also here, you can recognize the iron bars for the vertical lines, some specific details. To build the different panels. Here you can recognize 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different panels, 80 kilogram each one of them. Please pay attention to specific join, 25 centimeter in the top of the panels, a 5 centimeter for the lower join. Some specific elements, the pre-organization of the electric lines, and the external, and the frame. Exactly the same structure for the roof and the floor is quite easy. The idea is to change the geometry of the panels and to improve to the panels the structure to support the roof and the horizontal slab. And the idea is quite easy. If you have if you imagine to have a paper like this one, if you can change the geometry, you can improve the structure of this element. It's exactly the same. In this case, we change the geometry in this way. And with exactly the same elements, we have been able to build an element that supports 250 kilogram meter square, or an element that is, I don't remember, 8 meter and 50 for 43 centimeter. It's quite easy. Again, you can recognize the bars. Quite easy to organize, to define the geometry of these bars very quickly, and the construction of the elements. And here you can recognize when we move into the house is a way to build the horizontal slab, the structural horizontal slab with this very simple brick structure. And here we taste other geometry. And this is the interior. This is for the windows. I think that this is not so relevant. Very quickly, for built with concrete, yeah, to build a concrete frame for the windows. Quite easy. And this is the last step. Here you can recognize the construction. Here we are in Rio Quarto. It was a very interesting project made by Seve, involving 45 women. So the workers were only women. And as I told you, I repeat again, for the self-construction, the rules are, three main rules are very simple: no shattering, no electric machine, and no any elements heavier than 100 kilograms. Here, for example, you can recognize the principal iron bars that define the border and the geometry of the house, of the singular house. You can recognize the panels that have been combined, the both to define the wall. Here, you can recognize the different panels, and with some specific join for the lower part and for the upper part. And here you can recognize how to combine the two panels to build the wall. You can recognize the lower join, 5 centimeter, and here the upper join, that is the more interesting part. Please pay attention. Here we can recognize two things: a void, and into this void, 4 iron bars number 8. That means that if you put here concrete, you will transform this empty space in an horizontal beam that will close the vertical line of the house. You remember when I told you that you never use shattering? This is a way to build beams without shatter. No wood, no shatter. No specialized worker. Again, here you can recognize the void. Into this void, you will put to put concrete to build the beam. But the main, very quickly, other image about the windows, but I think that is not so interesting now. It's more interesting to talk about what happened. This is the interior. Here we can recognize the roof. again, 250 kilogram meter square. The very elementary houses, but the more interesting things has been to come back into this context after 3 years. And this is the main point for me, the more interesting point. We came back here, Seve came back here after 3 years or 2 years, 3 years, I don't remember in this moment. And they discovered that the different elements that they use for the construction of these 45 houses has been used also in the neighborhood for the other construction. What does it mean? That during this program, they train 45 people that they begin to build tiles, beams, walls, panels, and all these different elements. And after the construction of their own house, they begin to build these panels, this element for the neighborhood. That means that through this project, you solve the housing needness, but at the same time, you solve also the job. You insert also a job opportunity for the people that lives into this context. And here you can recognize some images of this context where we can recognize how the people who lives into this neighborhood begin to use these windows, these elements in the neighborhood. Very, very, very quickly, another techniques. This is a Domokanya. I show you these techniques because I think that is quite interesting. Is a way to design a dome, to build a dome. A dome is made by concrete and iron bars, but iron bars are quite expensive. And here in FAO, Raquel Barrio Nuevo begin to use bamboo lines instead iron bars. That means to make a dome cheaper. And it's a way to improve another techniques. Here we are in Spain with some students to train these techniques. It's quite easy. Please pay attention to the geometry of the, here you can recognize Raquel Barrio Nuevo from Lima. And this is the geometry of the dome made with the principal line. Is not is a grid. Please pay attention, it's a grid. The join is made by iron lines, very simple. Here you can recognize the principal geometry that support 200, 300 kilogram meter square with a chicken netch on the top and two chicken nets on the top and in the lower part of the dome. Then obviously, normally you should move the structure on the top of the house and close it with the concrete. Here we are in Lima. Again, we train again another, in an informal settlement, we train the same techniques. Please pay attention, this is 4 meter. Is quite big, this dome that is perfect and it supports perfectly these three very fat women. And here we taste it in a laboratory in Portugal. And this is another technique, but I don't want, here we are in Accra Kumasi in Ghana. And we thought how to change the tiles for the roof with micro concrete tiles that are cheaper and bigger. And the thing that here I was quite younger and And it's a way to substitute the, if you think in the informal settlement, usually we can recognize that the roof is made by wood structure with iron sheet. Iron sheet is quite bad. It's quite expensive, more or less 10 United dollars meter square. That is quite expensive, quite expensive and quite bad. And this is a way to think how to introduce another way to build the roof. And this is a factory where you can train the people to build the singular elements, precasting elements to use into the construction. And this is the geometry of the tiles and quite easy. Seconds to build one tile. That means that a worker is able to build 10 meters square each day. And this is, for example, a precasting elements for the roof. Okay, this is the, I'm going to move into the second project. This Un Techo para Vivir, this is a book that synthesize this different research that I think that is quite interesting, is a way to enter into this field and to understand how the self-construction can be a tool to improve the local development in the informal settlement. With the same approach, I'm going to show two, perhaps only one project. Here we are in Cambodia, is a project made by Architetti Senza Frontiere Italy, Architect Without Border Italy. And here we are in close to Phnom Penh in a rural village. And but okay, it's a rural area, but I think that is quite interesting because it's closer to the main road that join the Phnom Penh with the main port, with the main harbor, and Ho Chi Minh City. And in this area is, everything is changing and is arriving a lot of factory from external developers. And so in this moment, the context is something into rural to urban context. It's quite strange and I think that is quite interesting. And as usual, the first step is to understand how the people live into this context. And we recognize two different main types, talking about houses. And Cambodia, Myanmar, part of Thailand is a floating area. And so for this reason, the people build their own house with a palafitte structure, and all the roads are higher comparing the agricultural fields. Here you can recognize the different types. There's some different images that represent exactly the same types. And here again, the same, more or less the same structure into the field. And I think that please pay attention what happened at the ground floor, that I think that is a quite rich space where the people can bring, can do a lot of things, or perhaps they can insert some special function, like in this case, where they decided to insert a shop at the ground floor. So we can recognize that the private house is divided into two different parts. The lower part under the structure, under the house, that they use for the more public function, and the upper part in the first floor that is dedicated to the private house. Again, also here, we can recognize more or less the same elements. Talking about the school, we went to visit different examples made by the local government and made by the international cooperation, and more or less we recognize the same structure. From the urban point of view, we can more or less, the structure is the idea to define a courtyard, a central courtyard with the building all around the courtyard. Again, and talking about the topological aspect, the structure is quite easy, a very small corridor that survives, that brings the organize the different classrooms. Please pay attention talking about the dimension, talking about the corridor, please pay attention about the thickness of this element. In this case, also in the previous one, more or less, here perhaps is more evident. Here perhaps is more evident, is something 1 meter, 21 meter, 50 centimeter deep. So it's quite small from my point of view. Also here, we can recognize more or less the same interior quality. So the project is, I would like to share with you this project talking about two different aspects. The first is talking about the topological aspect, and the second part, as usual, how we build this building. Again, the idea is to think about the process and not the final product. Talking about the topological aspect, this is the plot, quite easy. We receive this plot. So I think that it's nothing special. And the idea has been quite easy, has been to organize the structure, the main six, buildings, six different classrooms with a larger corridor, and to leave some empty space into the different rooms, classrooms, sorry. And this is the reason I think that is quite easy. We recognize that the domestic space under the shade of the house that we have recognized into the private house as a very interesting space. We thought that perhaps it would be interesting to replay the same space into the schools. So we decided to leave this empty space with a large shadow that is quite comfortable to stay here. You can provide the cross ventilation, and there is also a way to stay outdoor, but at the same time to stay into the school. And we fix here the toilet area and this area for the extension. This is the first step that we built. This is the second step with the when we will insert the laboratory, and this is the third step when we will, now we have built this second part. Also this second part, the dormitory for the professor. This is, I think that this is interesting to say, to share, that this is a secondary school, and in Cambodia, you need to bring a professor from Thailand. So you have to provide the private house to the professor, because the reason is quite simple, because doesn't exist a professor, or there are few professors in Cambodia, because the Khmer Rouge period killed all the professors during the 1819. And in this very dramatic period. And this is the cross section that is quite easy. We decided to use earth blocks for the principal walls, and bamboo beams for the roof. The idea is to, again, to precasting the elements to involve the non-specialized worker into this process. That is a way to involve the local people who live into the village into this construction. And again, also the idea to use as the prefab precasting construction to use all the times the same elements. For this reason, we define only one beam that is 11 meter large, quite large, a bamboo beams, and to use exactly the same beams for all the constructions. Here you can recognize the two different facades, the lower one and the upper one. And sorry, coming back to the section, this is the north. Okay, we are in the tropic area, so it's not so relevant because the sun is quite 90 degree all the times, but this is the north. And it's in this way, it's easier to organize the water system and to bring the water in the lower part into a tank, two tanks. And talking about the foundation, I think that there is nothing special. Very simple, inverse beams. Perhaps it's more interesting talking about the horizontal slab. Usually is made by here. Usually you use iron bars. And we thought that perhaps it would be easier, not easier, cheaper, and more interesting to use bamboo lines instead to use iron bars. Here you can recognize the structure. The bamboo lines works very well in the compression and traction. And so we thought that perhaps it will be interesting to taste this solution. We insert the plastic paper. Here you can recognize the bamboo grid, and the second step to put the concrete. For the walls, we decided to use earth, and we decided to organize it to define earth blocks. And I hate earth, to be honest. I don't like as material because it's quite heavy. I'm going to finish. It's quite heavy, but at the same time, it is quite cheaper and easy. And we are going. We decided to organize the precasting construction of this block. And I think that is a great opportunity. I love this process because this means that you are working in all the process, construction process. What does it mean? You have to choose material, the first sample elements. The four samples steps, element, material, element, component, construction system. We are involved in all four parts of the construction. It means that you have to choose the earth, the first step. The second step, you have to design the earth, the block, the dimension of the block. And in this case, also the precasting of the blocks. That means to build these elements and to decide the different dimension. In this way, we have been able to build 18 earth blocks in only in one moment. Here you can see. And this is the same image about the construction walls. The bamboo, we went into the field to find the bamboo. This is an incredible bridge in the Mekong River, and made by, you can recognize here the cars, and it's quite primitive, but it's interesting. We went to find the bamboo, and with two student from Polytechnical in Milan. And the idea, very quickly, this is for the Windows, but I think that it's more interesting to share the solution for the construction of the beams. The bamboo, as I told you, is a great material for, it works very well on the traction and compression point of view. And for this reason, is more adequate for the pillars instead to be used for beams. For this reason, we decided to join 4 bamboo lines in this way. This is a very easy way to organize the 4 lines. To join, we built, this is a training made by Finland University. It's a workshop where they train these techniques that is quite easy. They build this casting, this mold, to join the 4 lines and to join the different bamboo with this iron bar. Here you can recognize the iron bar. And it is more or less, you can recognize the walls, the bamboo beams, the secondary lines, and the roof. Okay, this is the end. At the end, the school, here you can recognize the in the plan, moving into the corridor very quickly. Then I will come back. I come back at the beginning. The idea was to enforce, is quite different from the traditional schools that we visited at the beginning of our mission. We decided to enforce the element that divide the corridor from the landscape and to reduce the elements, the walls that divide the corridor from the classroom. This reason is quite easy to understand. The idea was to emphasize the relationship between corridor and classroom, because the corridor is a quite interesting place, is a part of the knowledge, it's a part of the school where you can improve your knowledge, the enjoy, play is part of the school. And for this reason, we thought that it was quite interesting to enforce this relationship. Otherwise, it was more relevant to divide the border of the school, to enforce the border of the school from the landscape from outside, where it's totally free, it's an empty space where you can play and you enter in another atmosphere, we can say. And here you can recognize the 2, here the first one, and this is the larger one, the second one, empty space under the natural shadow. This is the school. We decided to enlarge the corridor 3.5 meters for height meter high, 5 meter high. That is quite a monumental dimension. Here you can recognize through these windows how is totally free the relationship from the corridor to the classroom. That is also a way to enforce, this is the element that divide corridor and the classroom. That is a way also to enforce the cross ventilation, obviously. Some image of from the exterior. This is the interior, the classroom. Please pay attention, we never touch the roof with the walls. We are in a tropic area, so the roof is quite hot. So the idea is never bring the temperature of the roof to the walls. And in this way is I think that is a correct way to isolate and to divide these 2 elements. This is here in this image, I think that is quite evident, the relationship from interior to exterior, from the interior of the classroom to the exterior. And this is the corridor. You can recognize the dimension, 5 meters, 3 meters deep, this empty space, and the monumentality of this area. That is a way to enforce this element, this from the typological aspect, how to enforce, how to change the identity of this element. And this is the relationship with the classroom. Okay, this is the third part, but it's too late. This is the, I think that this is another school in Senegal, but I think that more or less replay exactly the same things that we taste here in Cambodia. So I think that it's not necessary to show you also this example. So to the end, the idea for today, I'm not sure to be if my lecture is coherent with your main topics, but the idea was quite simple to bring your attention from the, again, from the process, so from the product to the process. For us, I would like to repeat again, the main point is to understand how our architectural elements that we need, that we want to do into this context could be a tools. It could be a tool to improve the local development. It's a way to change the mind, to change the point of view, and to understand that the main point is how we do the things into this context and not only what we do. At the same time, as you can see here, I think that at the end also the final result is a crucial point. Thanks. That's all.
Thank you, Camillo. No, it fits in the program because of course the plurality of voices is very important to understand the different approaches, and this is one of the tasks of the summer school. And I think that a lot of things can be combined with what we are doing. For example, the work on the components, so to divide the architecture in different components with the specific solutions. And in the same times, what is a sort of fil rouge of all the workshop is understanding of the needs, okay? Of the needs of the population, understand of the context in terms of the possibility of the context. And this is something because our workshop is a little open in terms of the function that should be connected to a need. So to understand the need is one of the most problematic things. And I think that as you explain your project, your approach, this can be very, very useful. And after even the idea that architect can control all the process of the construction in some ways, can decide, not control, because after you leave people to build by themselves, but to have everything under control. So architect is not only specialized of something, but it's an open mind, should be open mind person. And so I think that it's perfect for this workshop, even because we have an intensive week, people came from abroad, from different culture and countries. And so maybe it's an opportunity to know your activities and your field of activities that sometimes is a little bit not so evident in literature and so on. So I think that from this point of view, of course, make us richest this lecture. And I'm talking from University of Pavia, that you know, but a little university, few professor, few possibility of know different kind, different approach of architecture. And so I'm sure that, for example, for my students, but I repeat for everybody, this enrich their career. So the task of summer school is not only to make one thing, but is to enlarge our vision. So thank you very much. I just ask to students, is there any kind of questions? That is all the time problematic. But in the same times, yes, a lot of your works are published. And so I think that if someone is interested in going deep, like in the last cases that we didn't have the opportunity to see, they can do it. So no questions?
I have a question. Professor Berizzi.
You are not a student, but you can do
I'm not a student, but if I can, I'd like to make this question.
Not yet a student.
Not yet a student. Thank you, Camillo, for your presentation. You show us some very nice experience. And that's why I'm making this question. So what is, in your opinion, the possibility of translating this kind of experience and this kind of technical solution that you have applied in this, of course, very particular country that I know very well, but what is the possibility of translate that kind of solution in a more usual context, like the ordinary context in which we work normally, like the one of today, the one in which we can apply, for example, the mobile unit that the students are designing in this moment?
I don't know. I think that it's not so easy to answer to this question. I think that I think that we should talk about, it will be how to organize, for example, to think how a mobile architecture could be changed by the people who lives into this house. And this means that you should shift the problem from the to produce the final solution, or to produce, we should say, hardware and software, to produce only the hardware of the house, for example, the main structure, the main elements, or I don't know, the main part of the house, and to leave free to the people to change part the software, and to make the people, to permit to the people to change from the specific needness. For example, this could be a solution, this could be an opportunity, and also to change, not so only to change part of the architecture at the beginning, but to change during the time, to think. This is another point that is quite interesting, I think. Talk about the time of the project. And again, if you think only about the process, only about the product, the time is quite short. And is 1 year, I don't know, 1-2 years, from the design to the production to the set. Quite easy, 1-2 years. If you begin to think about the process, you enlarge the time, for example, to 20, 30, 40 years. That means to think about the people, how the people will use your structure, and perhaps how they will need to change some part of the architecture for many reasons. Because they will need more empty space, or I don't know. In this case, perhaps it will be interesting to think to organize the project in hardware and software, which will be the heavier part of the project that will define the project, the shape, the house, and perhaps at the same time some soft. We should say soft part that the people could be add, insert, change during the time. This could be a topic that we bring from this informal context, and we bring it and we involve also in our context.
Thank you.